Thank you, Miss Doris. Isn't that a blessing to start our services off with that beautiful piano playing? Thank you and welcome to Corinth Baptist Church. My name is Andy Gibson. I'm the pastor here, and I want to welcome you personally and on behalf of our church. Brother Jason Westmoreland, our assistant pastor and youth minister, is just about to have the great privilege of baptizing his son Brandon. Isn't that a wonderful thing? Let's give God the glory this morning. Amen. Every time the baptismal waters are stirred, we're reminded that God is still moving, and we're thankful for it, and I'm expecting God to move today. If you're visiting with us, we want to say a special welcome to you, and if you can dig around in front of you and find one of the visitor cards, we would love for you to drop that in the offering plate. And if you're home folks, we welcome you as well. God bless you. This morning in Sunday school, I'll just get this out of the way, we had 137. Last week we had 147, and today's offering was $3,621. To God be the glory in Sunday school. Several announcements that I want to get out of the way, and before I forget this one, the Young at Heart group is going to eat at Mama Hamill's in Madison. How many of y'all ever eat at Mama Hamill's? Well, the rest of you, you missed out on the blessing. They're going to be going Thursday. The sign-up sheet is where the bulletins normally are out here out in the foyer. And they need to know, Ms. Charleston needs to know by Wednesday whether or not you're going. They're going to leave here at the church by 9:30 Thursday morning for lunch there. So don't miss that. Thank you to Ms. Eva Sullivan for the flowers today. We talked about Brother Jason and about the upcoming baptism. But also, I want to ask you to remember Brother Jason and his family. They've had a really hard couple of weeks with the loss of his grandmother, and then his stepfather Jim passed away. They buried him yesterday. So this is a precious family. Have a chance to encourage them. You do that, and thank you. Back to school rally August the 7th at Macedonia, 6:30 p.m. We'll have our church's monthly business meeting next Sunday following the evening service. The Brotherhood is going to have a very special barbecue. Did you say barbecue chicken? After Sunday, August the 18th, luncheon. It's a Brotherhood-sponsored lunch. You can carry it out or eat it in the fellowship hall, and it's going to be great, and the donations will be accepted towards the good work of the Brotherhood Fund. September 15th through 18th, we'll be having revival. More to come about that, and I invite everyone to be a part of praying in advance for revival services. You see several deacon recommendations here. We got a baby shower this afternoon. 2 to 3 p.m., mother-to-be Chloe Pitts in the fellowship hall, and I think I've covered it all. You can read the rest in the bulletin. I think that's all the announcements. May God bless you. Let me have a brief word of prayer, and then I'll ask Brother Jason to come. Lord, we just thank you that you are with us always, no matter what we're going through, no matter where we are. You're with us on the mountaintops. You're with us in the valleys. And Lord, we do want to say a special prayer to this morning for several families in this church that I know that have been in the valley, Lord, in difficult times. But God, we thank you for your faithfulness through those valleys. And Lord, we thank you that you're still God and that you're still on your throne. And Lord, we ask you to be with each one and strengthen them. Lord, we ask you to bless the services today. And Lord, right now we give you praise and honor and glory for saving another soul. Brandon has come. Lord, we ask you to bless this time, special moment of baptism, a father and his son. Bless Brother Jason, bless Brandon and their family. In Jesus' name, amen.
So great to be here with you this morning. And before we get started, I would like to say to the church, thank you so much for your encouragement and your prayers during this time. Losing my grandmother 2 weeks ago and then my stepfather this past Sunday. And it's been a difficult time, but here's the thing. God puts stuff in our path to help us through the valleys. And so I am privileged this morning to be able to baptize my son, but not just baptize, but today is my birthday. So God orchestrates things out in a way, and look, it's nothing about me, it's all about him. And so this morning, Brandon's coming to be baptized. Brandon, do you profess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? It is now my privilege, based upon your profession of faith, to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
we're going to change the order of things so I can get the choir up here to help us sing this difficult song. We're going to sing Baptized in Water, 398. And you may remain seated because we're going to stand up on our fellowship song. Baptized in Water, 398. Baptized in water, sealed by the Spirit, cleansed by the blood of Christ our King, heirs of salvation, trusting His promise, faithful. Second verse, choir, would you get to edge your seats and get ready to stand up and come on up here. Here we go. Ready? Baptized in water, sealed by the Spirit, dead in the tomb with Christ our King, one with His rising, and forgiven, thankfully now God's praise we sing. Sing that last stanza. Baptized in water, sealed by the Spirit, marked with the sign of Christ our one Father. Sing it now. Born of one Father, we are His children. Joyfully now God's praise we sing. Thank you very much. Page 63 will be our fun time. Because our lesson today, in so many ways, is going to be about the greatness of God. God has the power. He can speak anything into action. So we're going to sing Awesome God. You stand with me. We're going to have a responsive reading on this. Now, if you don't see it on the screen, which will be all right, you have it in your book, so turn to page 63. It's at the top of your book. God thunders marvelously with His voice. He does great things that we cannot comprehend. He is your praise and He is your God, who has done for you these great and awesome works your eyes have seen. Women, the Almighty, we cannot reach Him. He is exalted in power. You did awesome deeds that we did not expect. You came down and the mountains quaked at your presence. For the Lord your God is a God of gods, and the Lord of lords, the great, mighty, and awesome God who keeps His covenant of love. Let's sing Awesome God, page 63.
Start over. Our God is an awesome God.
Let's fellowship.
Several people here. I could call many names, but one in particular I want to mention who is a testimony to the greatness and the awesome power of God. Mr. Charlie Purser in the back right there. Wave at him, Mr. Brother Charlie. He was at death's door, but God has brought him back, and he's in the Lord's house today. Isn't God good? Let's pray to our great God. Lord, we thank you that you are great and awesome, and there is nothing, absolutely nothing, too difficult for you. Lord, we thank you that we have the privilege to serve you. We have the privilege to worship you. And today, Lord, I pray that you would prepare our hearts and minds as your people, individually and families and this whole church. Lord, it is our prayer that you will do what your disciples once asked in Galilee. Lord, increase our faith. Lord, would you grow our faith and our trust and our dependence on you? Would you grow our view of who you are and your greatness and your majesty and your power? God, help us never to have a small view of who you are. But Lord, grow our vision and grow our view of who you are and what you can do, because there is nothing too difficult for you. Lord, strengthen our faith. Encourage those who are weak and who are sick and hurting, and those who recently had the loss of a loved one. God, we lift each one up. And Lord, may the power of your Holy Spirit just surround them with your grace and with your strength. And Lord, today our prayer is that you and you alone would get all the glory. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Will you join us as we sing 162, Wonderful, Merciful Savior?
Thank you.
that beautiful singing. And our offertory now be 316. At the name of Jesus. What will happen at the name of Jesus in the end? Every knee will bow. They won't be asked that they want to bow. Every knee will bow. Let's sing it. Would you stand for our offertory, please?
At the name of Jesus. At the name of Jesus. Every knee shall bow in heaven and in earth.
Let's go to the top again.
At the name.
Darcy done got burnt because we had her slowing it down a little bit, and she went off to hear a group singing last week, and the pianist went wild, and she kind of got a craving on her, I guess. I love a song that has a story in it, and this story is from the Bible. Brother Andy's going to talk about one story that parallels to this one. This story here is about a lady that had been to every doctor she could think of, and nobody could find what was wrong with her. most of us have been in that situation before or known somebody who the doctors just couldn't figure it out. But she knew that God was all powerful, and she knew if she could just touch Jesus, that she would be healed. And I've seen experiences here today. There's examples here today that God has performed a miracle and healed people that could not be healed by man's ways. Let's sing Touching Jesus. The choir is going to help us.
A woman tried many physicians, yet grew worse, so to Jesus she came. And when the crowd tried to restrain her, she whispered these words through her pain. Touching Jesus is all that matters. Then your life will never be the same. There is only one way to touch Him. Just believe when you call on His name. I was bound when I knelt at an altar, but they said Jesus could meet every need. And when this prisoner finally touched Jesus,
listen to this,
he said, "Be free, praise the Lord, free indeed." Touching Jesus is all.
I sense the presence of the Holy Spirit here today, and I pray that you do too. And if you don't, you can touch Jesus today. You have your Bibles, turn with me to Matthew chapter 8, the 8th chapter of the Gospel of Matthew, and I'm thinking about many who are here who have recently, some very recently, experienced the loss of a loved one. I can relate to that because on yesterday, I spent most of the day at my neighbor's home. I don't know if any of you knew Mr. Monroe Eldridge and his wife, Miss Johnny Eldridge. Mr. Monroe, our next door neighbor, passed away yesterday at home. And sitting there for hours with Miss Johnny and her family and waiting for the moment. But knowing this, that when Jesus called Monroe home, he was able to touch Jesus and see him face to face. Isn't that good to know? And the ultimate healing that comes in the life of a Christian, the ultimate healing, and we thank God for all the healings that he gives us in our body, in this world, in this life, but the ultimate healing is when we take our last breath in this body, our last one here, is our first one in heaven, and we see Jesus face to face. Amen. And so take comfort in that today. No matter what you're going through, God has this under control. God is on his throne. He's in the healing business. He's in the restoration business. Whether it's in this life or in the life to come forever, God is an awesome God. Amen. This morning, we're going to read a scripture, Matthew chapter 8, verse 5. Verse 5 through 13 is the record of one of the times that Jesus saw fit to reach down and to do a miraculous healing in this life. Verse 5 of Matthew 8 says, "Now when Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion," that is a Roman soldier, "came to him, pleading with him, saying, 'Lord, my servant is lying at home paralyzed, dreadfully tormented.' And Jesus said to him, 'I will come and heal him.' And the centurion answered and said, 'Lord, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof, but only speak the word, and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to this one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes, and to my servant, do this, and he does it.' And when Jesus heard it, he marveled." Now, very few times in the scripture did Jesus marvel. He was amazed. Jesus heard it and he marveled. He said to those who followed, he said out loud, "Verily I say to you, I have not found such great faith, not even in Israel. I've not seen this kind of faith even in Israel." And he said in verse 11, "I say to you that many will come from east and west, and will sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the sons of this kingdom will be cast out into outer darkness, and there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." And Jesus said to the centurion, "Go your way, as you have believed, so let it be done for you." And his servant was healed that same hour. Lord, we thank you for your word today. We thank you that it is true and it is reliable. We thank you for your holy word, the Bible that we hold, God. Thank you that all of it is inspired by you and fully reliable and dependable to give us not only the guidance that we need today and in this life, but the guidance that we need for eternity. And Lord, I pray that today you will increase our faith. Lord, grow our faith. Take us from wherever we are. There are some here today, Lord, who've never place their faith in Jesus. God, would you give them the simple faith to take a step out and to believe on Christ today? Grow their faith, Lord. Begin it. Lord, for those of us who are Christians, what we're praying is that you would take us wherever we are in our spiritual life and, Lord, grow us in our faith. Teach us, Lord, to depend more on you, to trust more upon you, and not to trust on things that we ask for, but to trust on you and the goodness of who you are, your power and your authority. Lord, I pray you'd grow our faith today and do a work that only you can do. Do miracles today, Lord. I pray that you will continue to grow this church. It's my prayer, Lord, and thank you for answering it. We ask you, Lord, to grow us in the faith of Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. What is faith anyway? Well, you're exercising faith right now. You may not even realize it, but you are. The moment you chose to walk into this sanctuary and you picked out a place to sit and you sat in one of those pews right there, you put all of who you are and every bit of your being into the 18 inches of that padded pew. And when you did that, you said, I'm trusting it to hold me up. How many of you did that this morning? Don't even raise your hand. All of you did. You didn't think about it, but you did. You exercised faith. And when you come to Jesus Christ, and I'm praying that today someone else will be saved. We thank God every time. And we rejoice every time with the angels in heaven over one sinner who repents. And if God is speaking to you today, you need to exercise faith and trust Jesus to save you. He will. He promises to do that. Some of us have been Christians a long time, and we placed our faith in Christ maybe years ago, maybe decades ago. What I want to suggest to you today is God is not done growing your faith. He wants us not to just have faith, but to have more faith. He wants us to increase our faith. The disciples came to Jesus one day and said, Lord, increase our faith. And Jesus said, if you have faith like a mustard seed, you can speak to that mountain, be moved, and it'll be moved. He said, if you have faith, you can speak to that bush, it'll be plucked up and cast into the sea. And then he gave another story about faith and a mustard seed. It grows into a tree and a bush. It starts out small. He said it begins to grow, and even the birds of the air can find lodging in its branches. He talked about a little bit of leaven. How many of you ladies or men like to bake bread? If you do, raise your hand. Homemade bread. I want to get with y'all later. Nobody. One. Praise God. All right. And you know that you can have a great big bowl of dough, but it just takes a little bit of the leaven. The leaven goes in there and makes it grow and expand. And what God wants you and me to do is to grow in our faith. I thank God that babies grow. Aren't babies precious? And we love them. We welcome them into our home. We've had four that we have cared for in our home, and we love them. But I'm so grateful that they grow, because as they grow, they gain a little more independence. We have our oldest son, Joe, now, who's living practically independent, working on a ranch in Montana. And it's such a joy to see him mature and to grow. I love to plant a garden, and we put a seed in the ground. I love to see that seed sprout and to grow into a plant. Maybe it's a tomato plant. Maybe it's a corn, sweet corn. G90 sweet corn is one of my personal favorites. And to watch grow and blossom and bear fruit. God made living things to grow. And he wants your faith to grow today. He wants you to have more faith than you had yesterday. He wants you to have more faith than you had 10 years ago. He wants our faith to grow. Lord, increase our faith. That is our prayer. This man who was a centurion, came to Jesus with a great problem. And he said, Lord, verse 6, my servant is lying at home paralyzed, dreadfully tormented. And from that encounter with Jesus, this centurion's life was changed forever, because he came face to face with Jesus Christ, and he had to come to grips with who Jesus was and what Jesus can do. And in doing so, he exercised faith. Now, what makes this particular passage stand out from others is that it is a parable, it is a writing, it is a story, a record that Jesus speaks out and purposely tells everybody around him. And now you and I can hear it 2,000 years later. This man had such a great faith. What was it about this man's great faith that got Jesus' attention? I don't know about you, but I want to be an individual. I want to be a Christian. I want to be a follower of Christ that my faith gets Jesus' attention. Can I get a witness out there to you? I want to be that kind of follower of Jesus. And when I come to Christ and when I come to Jesus in faith, I know that he hears me, but I want to be that follower of Jesus that Jesus says, I take notice of your faith. Jesus did that for this centurion. Now, here was a man, he was a Roman soldier, probably Italian descent. He was stationed here in the Middle East, in the little land of Israel, to do his job. He was not just a soldier, he was a general, if you will, a centurion. He was over many different soldiers. And aren't you glad that Jesus came for everybody, no matter who we are or where we come from? In fact, he tells that story and that record in verse 11. He said that many are going to come from the east and west, and they're going to sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. The reason he said that was there were some wondering if Jesus had come for Italians. There were some wondering if Jesus had come for non-Jews, of non-Abrahamic descent. And I want you to know today, whoever you are and wherever you come from and whatever your background or whatever you look like, Jesus came for you. He loves you. He came for this centurion. And he says, in the kingdom of God, many are going to come from all over the world. We've been studying that on Wednesday night in the book of Revelation. An unnumbered multitude from every tribe and every tongue and every people. And we're going to get the privilege of serving God and worshiping him all throughout eternity. Amen. So this centurion comes to Jesus, and Jesus notices a great faith in him. When we meet Jesus, it changes us forever. I've been preaching a series on the subject of encounters with Jesus. We talked about many different ones in the Gospels who came to Christ for many different reasons. And each one, they left changed. And when you meet Jesus Christ, when you come to know Christ personally as your Savior, as your Lord, your life will change forever. If you're here today and you don't know him, he wants to save you today. And he promises to change your life forever, for the better, for all eternity. This man comes to Jesus and he exercises great faith. What is faith anyway? It is that trust in God. It is that dependence upon God. It is believing, not just with words, not what we say, but actually taking action in what we believe and who we believe on. You sat down in a pew, it didn't cost you a whole lot, it wasn't too risky, and it's held every one of you up. Your faith was placed in a good object. Amen. I sat down in a Coliseum chair during the rodeo 3 years ago, and it broke out from under me, and I fell on the concrete floor below. And I said, we're going to replace those chairs because they weren't trustworthy anymore. You can put all of who you are in Jesus. He'll never let you down. You put your trust in Christ. He will never, ever let you down. What kind of faith does it take that's noticed by Jesus? How does this man get Jesus' attention to the point that our Lord said, I have not found this kind of faith in all of Israel? That's what I want to share with you this morning. It is my prayer that God will grow our faith. And I'm going to issue a challenge to you and to me today. I'm going to tell you what it is in just a moment. But I challenge you to take it up and see what God's going to do when we grow our faith in him. The points I want to share with you are these, and I'll outline them briefly, then I'll go back over them. First of all, this man came to Jesus with a desperate need. That's point number one, a desperate need. He had a problem that he couldn't fix. Secondly, he had a determined prayer. He was determined to keep praying to Jesus and pleading. And finally, he had a direct trust in Jesus himself. Desperate need, a determined prayer, a direct trust, and let's go over them together. First of all, a desperate need. I know that in a congregation this size, I know there are people here today who have a desperate need. Now, some of you, life may be a bed of roses, and everything may be going perfectly well, but everybody is going through a crisis at some point in our lives. We're either coming out of a crisis, we're going into a crisis, we're in the middle of one. Some of you are in the middle of a crisis right now. I want you to know God knows your situation. He knows where you are. He knows exactly what you're going through. He knows the desperate need of your heart. And you know, it's those desperate needs that bring us to Jesus. Notice it in verse 5. A centurion came to him. You might want to underline that in your Bible. The centurion came to him. Who knows what might have happened if this man's desperate need had not come to pass. He had a sick servant at home. Now, in those days, a servant was like a family member, a member of the family. And this man had a sick servant who was helpless and hopeless. And that man was lying there on his back, paralyzed, unable to do anything for himself, and it says he was also tormented. He was in pain the last 2 days. That describes our neighbor pretty well. He was lying flat on his back, paralyzed, tormented. And it's those needs that bring us to the point, to the realization that you and I need a Savior. We need a healer. We need a deliverer. Let me put it plainly, we need Jesus. Amen. I met with a man this week named Reuben Moore. He was on our prayer list here at this church back last year. Last year, Reuben Moore, who was used to work at Mississippi State University, one of the vice presidents of the Agriculture Science Department, last year he was diagnosed with a terminal illness, a terrible leukemia that was certain to take his life. And he decided to get the treatments, and he went to get the treatments. I had not seen Reuben in quite some time, in fact a year, but I looked him up this week. I went to his cabin at the Neshoba County Fair. I wanted to see him face to face, because the last time I heard from him, he was in a very, very difficult time, having a total stem cell transplant, y'all. That is when they kill every cell in your body, and then they begin to build it back. Amazing scientific treatment. When I walked up on that cabin floor, there was Reuben reading the newspaper. I didn't know exactly how he would look. I turned the corner, and he looked healthier than the last time I'd seen him, y'all. God did a miracle in his life, and he extended his life. And I asked him, I said, Reuben, what were you thinking during those dark days of this stem cell transplant and the treatment? He said, I'm going to tell you, Brother Andy, he said, I've never been that close to God in my whole life than the time that I spent in that hospital down at MD Anderson undergoing that treatment. He said, because for the first time in my life, the only one I could turn to was Jesus. Some of you can relate to that today. You come to church today, you've got a desperate need. You don't know where to turn. You can't help yourself. You're hopeless and you're helpless and you're lying flat on your back and there's nowhere else to go. And what I want to tell you today is we need to thank God for our desperate needs, because they bring us to the one who can help. They bring us to the one who can save. They bring us to Jesus himself. Amen. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. And in your desperate need, Jesus is still available. Jesus is not far away. He's only a prayer away. And you come to Christ and you believe on him, and he will save you and he will rescue you. This man came to Jesus because he had a sick servant who needed help. He came on behalf of someone else who needed help, and he came to Jesus. It was a desperate need that brought him to Jesus in the first place. I'm so glad that we serve a God who doesn't have levels of difficulty, aren't you? If you asked me to move this microphone right here, that microphone right over there, to take it down and hand it to Brother Donald, that's something I can do. If you ask me to move this chair right here, I can pick it up and I can take it down here by Miss Doris if you ask me to do that. If you ask me to move this pulpit right here, I'd be calling for help, y'all. And you to come help me, I know. But if you ask me to move that piano or that organ, I'd say, I'm sorry, I can't help you a bit. All right, we'll have to call somebody else. There is nothing, no need too great for our great God. He doesn't know any levels of difficulty. God can do anything. He created everything in a moment of time. He spoke this whole world and everything in it into existence, and that same Jesus is Lord today. And whatever desperate need that you have, the answer is not how to figure it out on your own. The answer is not to try to do it by yourself. You don't have to walk that road alone. You come to Jesus. You bring your need to him. That was this man's first step of faith. His second step was a determined prayer. He had a desperate need and he had a determined prayer. Now, in the other Gospels, the records are that he sent people ahead of time. He actually sent people out to find Jesus because he needed Jesus to come. And so they went out and Jesus delayed, and they went out some more delay. And finally, apparently, he comes. My point is this. Jesus told this parable about an unjust judge who was He was only a judge for the money, okay? He was only interested in himself. He had no concern for anybody else. But there was a widow woman who had a need, and she kept pleading her case before him. And he didn't hear the first time, and he didn't hear the second time. But when she got up in the middle of the night and went and knocked on his door, he said, "Fine, what do you want?" And Jesus' point was this: if an unjust judge will give relief to a widow woman in a desperate need, you can bring whatever need you have to our good God, and he will answer your prayer. He will hear your prayer. He will help you in your time of need. Jesus said, that's why I want you to keep asking. Ask and you shall receive. Keep on asking. Seek and you shall find. He said, keep on knocking and the door will be answered. If God doesn't answer your prayer the first time, don't give up and walk away. You keep on with a determined prayer. I think sometimes we treat God as if he's some sort of a mail order catalog or Amazon where we can just order up what we want. And, you know, if it doesn't arrive the next day, we're done with that, right? No. It's about faith. And when you come to God in prayer, when you bring your desperate need to God in prayer, you need to understand he hears you and he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. God wants us to continue to ask. He wants us to continue to believe, to continue to trust in a determined prayer. Prayer makes a difference. Prayer changes things. But we have become a people too busy to pray. We've become a people too busy to pray. George Mueller was a man back in the 1800s in England who God put on his heart to begin an orphanage for children who had no homes. And what God laid on his heart was not to depend on a group of investors or some rich benefactors. God put on George Mueller's heart, he said, if God wants to build this orphanage, God will make it happen. And George Mueller said, I am going to never ask anybody for a penny, but I'm going to go to God every day and ask him to build this orphanage. And every need that they had, y'all, was met. George Mueller demonstrated the power of prayer. One time they were threatening to turn off the power to the gas to the place, to the heat to the place, and they got in their closet and they prayed. And within a matter of moments, someone sent a kind donation to the door, and it exactly met the need. What I'm asking you to do, what I'm challenging you today, is to let God grow your faith through prayer. If I asked for a show of hands, I said, how many of you want God to grow your faith? Everybody's hand would go up. But here's the challenge. It takes time. It takes effort. And my challenge to you and to me is this week, the week of August the 4th, 2024, would you spend 1 hour of your life, 1 hour of the many hours that God gives you, would you spend 1 hour solid, straight in prayer to God? Bring your need to God in prayer. Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane. He asked his disciples to pray. You know what they did? They went off under an olive tree and fell sound asleep. They started well. They tried to pray. And Jesus went and found him and said, could you not even pray with me 1 hour? We're talking about Jesus here, our Savior, who went to the cross hour upon hour, suffered and bled and died in my place and in your place, and nails through his hands and his feet and a crown of thorns on his head. And those disciples couldn't even spend 1 hour just before that with him in prayer. I want to ask you to take whatever need you have in your life. Maybe it is a spiritual need. Maybe it is an emotional need. Maybe it's a financial need. Maybe it's your marriage. I want to remind you today, nothing is too hard for God. God has the power to save your marriage. God has the power to solve your financial situation. God has the power to meet your needs. God has that power. He has that ability. He often uses people, and he loves to use his church. But what we need to do is to come with our desperate need in a determined prayer to God. I want to challenge you to pray for this church. I want to challenge you to pray for your family 1 hour this week. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands. But if you're willing to do that, if you're willing to come to God in a determined prayer, and ask God to move and willing to trust in Christ to answer that prayer, would you say, I will, I will? Now, determined prayer gets Jesus' attention. Jesus said, I've not seen this kind of faith all throughout Israel. Time after time, he sent for Jesus. Finally, he came. And you pray. I want to ask you all to pray as part of your hour of prayer. I want to ask you to pray for revival. September 15th through 18th, we're going to have revival services. But I just want to tell you, we don't need revival services. We need old-fashioned revival. We need men and women of God to get serious with God and say, Lord, I want to take what time I have. I want to take my life. I want you to use me in this church, in this place, and reach people here and outside these walls and around the world. And God, I'm willing to give you my time. I'm willing to give you my treasure. I'm willing to give you my talents that you've given to me. I want to give some of it back to you. Would you spend 1 hour with God in determined prayer this week? Don't say you will if you won't. So are you ready? I'm going to ask you. If you will, say I will right now. I will. And let's just see what God can do. He will. Amen. Desperate need, determined prayer, directed trust. It's all about trust. It's all about faith. I want you to read these few verses here, and then we'll be through. This man said in verse 8, Lord, I'm not even worthy that you should come under my roof. Only speak a word, and my servant will be healed. He said, I have authority. I know what authority is about. I can give a command, and it happens. This one goes. This one comes. My servant does it. And when Jesus heard it, he marveled. He was amazed because he saw this man had his faith in the right place. His faith was not in what Jesus might say or what Jesus might do. His faith, y'all, was in Jesus. When you put your faith in Christ, you can trust him. You can depend upon him. He doesn't have to come to your house. He's still moving. Amen. He doesn't have to come to your place of business. He doesn't have to show up, walk down these aisles so we can all see him, because Jesus is moving because he has the authority and the power to do it. Matthew chapter 28, the Great Commission. How do you know it, preacher? Jesus told us as he left this world, Matthew 28, 18, Jesus came and spoke to them saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things I've commanded you. And Jesus said, lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. That's our commission. It's not a suggestion. It's the reason we're here. It's the reason there is a Corinth Baptist Church. You and I need to fall on our face before God in our quiet place, in whatever quiet space or closet, or even in your bedroom. Fall before God and ask God to move in a mighty way to reach people for Jesus Christ. A directed trust. You've got to put your trust in the right one. His name is Jesus. This man put his trust in Jesus as to who he is. He said he could, twice in this text, this centurion referred to Jesus as the Lord. He didn't say, hey, buddy. Sometimes we come to God and we're so disrespectful. Can I just say that? God is not your best bud, all right? God is Almighty, Sovereign God, sitting on the throne of all of the universe. And it's only by his grace that we have the privilege to come to him in prayer at all. And when we come, we should come understanding who he is. He is a great and awesome God. And the centurion said, Lord. You know what Lord is? King. It means I'm submitting my life to you, Jesus. It means I'm giving myself to you, Jesus. I'm coming to you as Lord. Jesus saw it and he said, that's great faith. Secondly, he put his trust in Jesus' word. He said, Jesus, you don't have to come to my house. Just speak the word, and I believe it. I'm trusting your word. And you know what? That same Jesus has given us his word right now. He's given us his holy word, and we can trust him. What he says is always true. And finally, He trusted Jesus' authority. He said, I know what authority is about. I give an order, my men come. I give them another order, they do something else. Jesus, you have authority. I trust you. Jesus, he said, I trust you. A desperate need, a determined prayer, a directed trust. Make sure your trust is not what God can do for you today. Make sure your trust is not that your life is going well. Make sure your trust is not in your bank account. Make sure your trust is not in your health savings. Make sure your trust is not in how well your body is doing. Make sure your trust is not in this life. Make sure it's in Jesus Christ. When you put your trust on Him, He will never let you down. Yesterday, I was reminded of this as I sat in the bedroom with a dying man and his wife. This man I had pastored years ago. He served as a deacon. But later in life, he had gotten dementia. His body began to fail, and his wife has spent the last 10 or 12 years basically caring for him. So they've not been able to go to church very often as they once had. But as this man was slipping away, I reminded them of this fact. First of all, that this man, Monroe, was ready to meet Jesus. He had put his trust in Jesus long ago. Secondly, he'd served the Lord. He'd spent his life serving the Lord, and especially in later years, serving the Lord as a deacon and in other ways. And even though the last few years he'd not been able to, he was ready to go. And then as his life faded from his body, I reminded Miss Johnny of this truth, that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Amen. Jesus even has authority over death. Jesus has authority over your end of life experience. Jesus is the one who walked out of the grave. Amen. Are you ready to let God increase your faith? Do you want to be that individual that Jesus says, I've not seen faith like this in a long time? I want to be that person. I hope that you do. I want our church to be known as a church of faith, that when we pray, we believe that God hears us, and we trust in Jesus, not just in what we're asking Him to do for us today. We trust Him no matter what. Bring your desperate need to Jesus. Come to Him in determined prayer. Direct your trust in Jesus Christ and let God grow your faith. I want to encourage you to embrace your need today. Stop trying to fix it by yourself. You can't move that piano. God can. Embrace your need. Spend 1 hour with our Lord Jesus in prayer. Just 1 hour this week and see what God will do. You may not be able to see it immediately. This man had come to Jesus time and time again. But it did something inside that no eye could see. It grew his faith to a point that it got Jesus' attention. And thirdly, make sure your trust is in the Lord Jesus alone. God, I thank you for your word today. Lord, I'm asking you to do a miracle. Lord, we ask you to do a miracle of growth. We thank you for the growth that you have designed in life. And Lord, we're asking you to do a spiritual growth here. Help us to grow in our faith, to be people that when you look at us, you see people of great faith. Lord, I thank you that your grace is sufficient for everyone. We cannot do it. We can't grow anything. But Lord, you grow our faith. We're asking you to do that. If there's someone here today, Lord, it's lost. And if they died this very moment, they would spend it in eternity in a Christless hell. God, would you save them today? Give them the faith to believe. And Lord, us as believers, grow our faith. Help us to depend more on you, because at the end of the day, you're the one with all authority over life, over death, over eternity. Our Lord Jesus, in your name we pray. Amen. If God's spoken to you this morning and you have a decision to make, you need to come. As we stand and as we sing, don't you wait. You come right now.
Softly and tenderly, 414. Softly and tenderly Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals he's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. Come home, come home. Ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home. Why should we tarry when Jesus is pleading, pleading for you and for me? Why should we linger and heed not his mercies, mercies for you and for me? Come home. Come home, ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home. Time is now fleeting. The moments are passing, passing from you and from me. What gathering deathbeds are coming, coming for you and for me. Come home, come home. Come home, earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home. Oh, for the wonderful love he has promised, promised for you and for me. Though we have sinned, he has mercy and pardon, pardon for you and for me. Come home, come home. Is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home. Sing that first verse. Softly and tenderly Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals he's waiting, watching, watching for you and for me. Come home, come home. Ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling. Calling, oh sinner, come.
We're not going to draw this out, but we're going to sing one more
Let's sing that beginning at Come Home. That is chorus. If God has spoken to your heart, I don't want to close the door on what God is doing. If God's spoken to your heart today and you know that you have a decision to make, you come right now. Don't wait. Let's sing that chorus.
Sing the chorus.
Come home.
Ready?
Come home. Come home. Ye who are weary, come home. Tenderly Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home.
Why should we tarry? Verse 2.
Why should we tarry when Jesus is pleading, pleading for you and for me? Why should we linger and heed not his mercies? Mercies for you and for me. Come home, come home. Ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home.
Sing a third one.
Time is now fleeting, the moments are passing, passing from you and from me. Shadows are gathering, deathbeds are coming, coming for you and for me. Come home, come home. Ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home.
Sing just the chorus.
Come home, come home. Ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come.
God is moving. I'm going to ask every head be bowed, every eye be closed. Miss Doris, you continue to pray. Now, moments like these are not often in a Baptist church. So, Jesus, I want to thank you for moving. I want to thank you for calling people home. I want to thank you for saving souls today. Lord, we want you to grow our faith, because we know you can do more. We thank you for what you have done this morning. Lord, we recognize that we stand on holy ground. Bless these who've come, God. There are others here that need to make decisions, and you've spoken to them, Lord. They know. So we're going to sing one more chorus. If God's spoken to you, you don't wait. You come. You're standing in the presence of Jesus. Come to him right now as we sing.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals, he's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. Come home. Come home, ye who are weary,
Jesus is here, and he has spoken, and he has moved mightily this morning, and he gets all the glory. Amen. We want to welcome. There's so many decisions, I can't keep up with them. Bro, Tim and Miss Eva, you come right here. Tim and Eva come. Brother Tim comes today to move his letter from Pear Orchard Baptist Church and to unite and become a member here at Corinth Baptist Church, and right alongside his wife, Miss Eva, and their family. If you rejoice with me and on their decision, would you say praise the Lord right now? Praise the Lord. We welcome you, and we are excited about what God is going to do as a result of you being here. Come on up here, Wes and Leslie. Look, Wes comes today. He said, I'm coming by statement of faith. Wes has been baptized before, but you all know Miss Leslie here, and God has been working in his life, and he said, I want to follow Jesus right here at Corinth Baptist Church. If you rejoice in his decision for their family, would you say praise the Lord? Praise God. God is good. Tanner, come on up here, Tanner. Tanner comes today, and he said, I want to receive Jesus Christ and profess him publicly as my Savior and Lord. And another soul has been saved. We're going to be having more baptisms. Amen. If you rejoice with Tanner in his decision, say praise the Lord. God is great. Amen. And where are they? Okay. both of y'all come. Rick and Carol Patrick come today to unite with the fellowship here at Corinth Baptist Church. They're moving their letter. They're no strangers to us, but they're moving their letter from First Baptist Jackson, and we welcome them here. If you rejoice with me and with them in becoming part of this church family, would you say praise the Lord? Hey, one more time. Y'all ready? God bless. One more time. Look here. Taylor and Courtney, come right here if you would. Taylor and Courtney, well, first of all, on that last course, Taylor, God moved you to step out in faith. And he came today. He walked the aisle when he was a boy, but he said, I want to make certain that I'm following Jesus. He comes today for salvation and for baptism here at Corinth Baptist Church. If you welcome him to this church family, and this lady right here, Miss Courtney, wants to be baptized. We're going to have a double husband-wife baptism. Praise God. If you rejoice, say praise the Lord. We welcome you. Courtney, Taylor, we love you. God loves you. We prayed together, and we want you all to line up right here. Don't you leave this place, all right? Families, if you'd like to come stand with these who've made decisions, you come and stand. Isn't God good? Now, don't nobody go home and complain about the long-winded preacher, all right? Brother Jason, would you come, and would you close us in a word of prayer? Yes. Oh, yes. You ain't getting out of here that quick, all right? We have deacon elections for our members. It'll be very, very quick after we're dismissed. If you're visiting, you're welcome to slip out. But for the members, we need to have deacon election right after this. And so the deacons prepare to pass those ballots out. Brother Jason, you close us in a word of prayer. Yeah.